So the gospel lesson is from Luke chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. But on the first day of the week, at early dawn, they went to the tomb, taking spices from which they prepared. And they found the stone rolled away from the tomb, but when they went in, they did not find the body. While they were perplexed about this, behold, two men stood by them in dazzling apparel. And as they were frightened and bowed their faces to the ground, the men said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? Remember how he told you, while he was still in Galilee, that he must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and then rise on the third day." And they remembered his words, and returning from the tomb, they told all this to the 11 and 12 arrested. Now it was Mary Magdalene and Joanna and Mary the mother of James and then other women, but with them who told this to the apostles. But these words seemed to them an idle tale, and they did not believe them. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Alicia. You love stuff. Join me in a moment of prayer this day. Gracious God, we are so thankful to you for the gifts that you give us, the gifts of those who have touched our lives. And so we ask that you be with us this special day as we remember your Son and his blessing to us. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, it's a sad day for us in some ways, but it's a joyous day as well. However, it was a sad day all across America and all over the world when news finally spread. The rumors were true. There was no denying it. Elvis, the king of rock and roll, was dead. And yet it is interesting how many people claim to have witnessed seeing the king alive, even when the reports were confirmed of his death. I shared with folks this morning that I worked for the Mayo Clinic at one point, and they conducted the autopsy on Elvis. I hate to break it to you, but he is gone. I'm sorry. But no matter how great someone is, at some point, we will all face death. And the saddest part of all is when we continue to look for something when, in fact, the search is over. There has been only one who was able to conquer death. Jesus of Nazareth, God on earth, defied all odds and broke through the bonds of death, hell, and the grave to once again walk on earth alive and well. The documentation is irrefutable. Jesus, who was crucified, is now alive. Jesus, who was cruelly beaten and battered, nailed to a cross and pierced for good measure. Jesus, who was taken down from a Roman torture device and laid in a borrowed tomb, signed, sealed, and delivered, would not be restrained by the grave. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
I forgot to tell you all that I believe in call and response. It's one of these things in a tradition. So I say something like, as the call, amen.
Amen.
There's your response. There it is. We'll be doing a lot of that today. This is one of those sermons. Jesus was among the living, later to appear to numerous witnesses who attested to the account that, in fact, Jesus did return from the dead. This is a day to celebrate. This is a day to rejoice. Amen?
Amen.
We remember this day as if it just happened. The power of Jesus Christ reigns in all of us, now and forever. Hallelujah. This is exciting stuff. The light of the world had come to the lost. We no longer have to remain prisoner to our sin. Jesus sacrificed himself to ensure that we could have life and have it more abundantly. Instead of a funeral, we are in the presence of a renewal. Jesus Christ is alive. See, I didn't even have to do it that time. That's awesome. So why on earth are we looking for him among the dead? Luke 24, 5-8 says it this way. Why do you look for the living among the dead? He is not here. He is risen. Remember how he told you while he was still with you in Galilee? The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men, be crucified, and on the third raised again. Then they remembered his words. This must have been the aha moment of the century. Jesus wasn't kidding. He wasn't speaking in parables or circles. He meant what he said. He was going to die, and then after 3 days, he was going to rise again. And they do say that hindsight vision is
20/20.
There you go. Suddenly, all of Jesus' teachings were starting to make sense. Resurrection, I mean, that whole idea of resurrection, is an interesting thing. Anybody here work in the medical field? Yes? Just say yes. That's good. All right. You know that from a medical perspective, people are resurrected or resuscitated every single day. Happens every day. We hear accounts of those whose hearts had stopped beating, and then they're just zapped back to life. Yes? Okay. But there's only so much that medical science can do. When someone is dead for more than a certain number of minutes, not days, but minutes, there really is no hope. They cannot be resuscitated. They simply pass from this life to the next. But Jesus was not the result of a brilliant breakthrough in medical science. Jesus, the Son of God, would not be contained by death. Jesus, the Messiah, would not be constrained by grave clothes. Jesus, our Redeemer, would not be held back by a tombstone. Jesus is alive, not a corpse or a resuscitated ghost, but once again, both fully human and fully divine. And just for a note, I don't mind the babies. I don't know about you all, but I just think this is awesome! You know, this is great. I love it. I just think it's call and response. So there we go. And yet the disciples are still a little stunned by the devastation. They were in hiding, fearing that the Roman soldiers would come for them next. The women who followed Jesus, they were present at his hasty burial. And so they had to return to the tomb to do the unpleasant but necessary task of completing that burial process. The Romans still thought they had taken care of another nuisance. Everyone was looking for Jesus among the dead. So how about us? Are we still trying to bring Jesus in the midst of the dead? I've mentioned this before, but I mentioned it this morning too. There's several court cases involving various colleges across the nation, and if I'm not mistaken, one of the colleges was the University of Maryland, where instructors were challenging students who believed in God. The movie God's Not Dead follows an encounter of a philosophy instructor and a freshman class in which one student refused to sign the instructor's mandatory affidavit stating God is dead. In the story, the freshman then spends the rest of the semester convincing his classmates of the existence of a higher being, of God. And in the end, the students stand and affirm, God is not dead. So what about us? Are we still searching for meaning in our lives? Are we still searching in vain to appease our innate restlessness when all the time we could find rest in the risen Savior? Maybe we're wrestling with something else today. Maybe we're wrestling with indifference. It really doesn't matter if God is alive or dead. It doesn't matter if Jesus rose from the dead or whether this is just a cleverly crafted myth. It simply doesn't matter. And yet if we're wrestling with that, I wonder, would that lead to mere existence? One lacking hope for a blessed life now and a promise of eternal life. Are we expecting life or are we expecting existence? Do we want to dare to believe in a loving God who walks with us during times of trial and difficulty? Do we have the courage to stand against the hateful, harmful actions of others and promote a life of peace and love? God is in our midst today, amen?
Amen.
Christ is risen and the grave is missing one more inhabitant. We remember these events as the pinnacle of the Christian year. Christ is here with us and Christ does not dwell among the dead. Christ is seated at the right hand of the Father and yet still in our midst, lighting a spark of excitement and hope and courage. Do you dare to believe? Dare to believe. I think spring is this interesting time. I saw my son was telling me about it's a Facebook post that says weather in Maryland, and I think it was 71 degrees one day, a thunderstorm the next day, a blizzard the third day, minus temperatures the fourth day, 85 the next day, and then whatever, you know. We survived the time change, amen? You all with me? So it's on to having the sun set later in the day, spring sports and events, special programs at school, and all the signs of life are around us. There's a story of a Sunday school teacher who gave her students an assignment one Easter Sunday morning. They were to take small boxes outside, and they were to gather items from around the church that represented Easter. And so all the children were excited and proceeded outside to find their treasures. One child was just a little uncertain, and yet he was eager to complete the task. He was a special needs child, but he had a big heart and an intense love for Jesus. And he too went on his quest and returned with the other children. And so the teacher had each child present their findings. One child had some fresh grass, indicating new life after a time of winter. One had a few twigs from a bird's nest, indicating the birth of new birds and a sign of spring. Another child brought a flower that had just been bloomed. But the young boy also presented his findings. He presented an empty box. And the other children were quick to criticize. He didn't do the assignment right. I did so, said the boy. The tomb is empty. Amen?
Amen.
There is no better declaration. When the disciples finally came to the realization that Jesus was no longer among the dead, there is no better declaration for us as well. Jesus is among the living. The tomb is empty.
Amen.
We are among the living, amen?
Amen.
We are Easter people, and we live in the promise and hope of a kingdom of God here on earth and in heaven. Perhaps it's time to realize just how much we are loved. Perhaps it's time for us to embrace the fact that we don't have to carry our burdens alone anymore. Perhaps it's time for us to accept the fact that God is absolutely crazy about each and every one of us. So much so that God sent God's only Son to pave the way for us to experience life and to experience it more abundantly. So where do we go from here? This is the so what part of the sermon. We know the story and we acknowledge the presence of life of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Does the story end here, or is it just the beginning? Maybe we're at a crossroads. What path is God asking us to follow? This is where we can seek God and find direction for our faith community. This is where we will find answers for the cares and concerns of our lives at the foot of an empty cross. Amen?
Amen.
I have to admit, our world's a little scary right now. Don't know if you believe that or see that or not. It's no secret that our nation is in a bit of turmoil as we see the results of hatred and racism that are just running rampant at this time. There's a special candle lit on the altar today. In memory of those who lost their lives to terrorist attacks in both Brussels and the Ivory Coast. These things just continue, and it's rampant in our world. And so against this backdrop of evil, we find the source of love itself. We find a peacemaker among the warriors. We find a gentle spirit among those who cry for signs of force. The fact that Jesus is among the living gives us the opportunity to follow his guidance and his example. Jesus boldly extended the arms of hospitality to everyone. This is our model to follow. Can we welcome all, both inside and outside these four walls? Can we extend the hand of hospitality that includes God's grace offered without price? Can we take this Easter excitement and extend fellowship to one another as we share God's love with our neighbors? Can we do that? Just say yes.
Yes.
This is where we can be the real presence of God in our community. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us not look for and share it to all who desire a relationship with God. The tomb is empty. The search is over. Christ is